on the stage is only one score away to bring the giant down. He's the strange amateur thing with the one that foot on the devil's wings.
Tonight's upload is brought to you by our patrons from the Patreon page. That's Cecilia Spears, Hawaii, Carl Eakins, Catherine McClear, Sean Campbell, Iron Alexa, Allison Saib, Ryan Woodward, Bree, and Bonanza Jellybean. Thank you guys so much for supporting the channel through Patreon. And if anybody listening right now enjoys the content of the 80 Slasher Librarian YouTube channel and would like to help keep it going and growing for a long time to come, then click the link in the description below and sign up on Patreon for as low as $2 to $5 per month. You get some great rewards depending on the tier you select and early access exclusive content before it reaches YouTube. And enjoy tonight's upload of Child's Play 2, the novelization by Matthew Costello. Once there was a doll named Chucky, who did naughty, wicked things like murder. But Andy and his mother killed Chucky, killed the madman whose deranged spirit possessed the doll, killed him once and for all. That's what they think. Andy's in a foster home now. His mother is undergoing psychiatric treatments. And Chucky? The toy makers decided there was nothing wrong with the doll, so they rebuilt him. Now Andy has more reason than ever to fear for his life. Chucky's back, and he wants Andy's soul. Child's Play 2 by Matthew J. Costello. Chapter 1. He looked down into a vast, bottomless cavern, its twin walls filled with jagged points and razor-sharp edges. It seemed to go on forever, into an abysmal blackness. Something monstrous was right there, right next to the cavern, hovering, shimmering. It caught the light, and it reflected the light right back at him, right up to its optivisors, magnifying lenses that he wore, which looked like the most high-tech prescription eyeglasses ever made. "No good," Bob Meyer said, pulling back and then flipping the optivisors up. His eyes crossed as the room shrunk back to normal proportions. He looked over at the other technician, the other sap who had been dragged out of bed at 4 a.m. to work on this. He looked at the black mess in front of him. It was no longer recognizable, not as a doll. The head, what was left of it, was held in a vise. All of the plastic filament hair had been burned into a thick crud that stuck to the skull frame like tar. The other technician, an old-timer who had been with Playpal's toys from the beginning, licked his lips and gestured at the thing with his hands. Hal Turner had helped create it. Not that he ever got a penny from the thousands, the millions that were sold, but he had been there from the beginning, working on the design, making the primitive animatronics work. Now he acted like an embarrassed father who sees that his kid has gone wrong. A little breaking and entering, a little first-degree murder. Where did I go wrong? I'll move the light, Turner said, coughing as if nervous at how thin his voice sounded in the large lab. Meyer nodded while Turner positioned the light behind the doll's deformed head. Now the head was outlined, and Meyer could almost make out the sickeningly recognizable shape, the cute, adorable face that America's Rugrats loved, the good guy doll. Except this one had been through hell and back. No, something worse than that. This one had done something bad, or so the papers said. That's good, Meyer said, watching the light fall into position. He flipped down the optivisor, and the lab blurred into mammoth proportions. Okay, he said. Now let's take another look. Meyer leaned close to the skull, and the closer he came to the head, the more he smelled the foul stench of burned plastic. He peered at the one eye left in the head, looking into the crack. If there was something wrong with the doll's photoelectric and audio sensors, it would show up here. The eyes actually acted as sound and movement sensors. The doll could detect where a sound was coming from, turn its head and say, "Hidey-ho, wanna play?" And that's about all it was supposed to do. That, and utter a few more reassuring things like, "I like to be hugged." But this was one that just didn't like to be hugged. This doll, Chucky, had done a whole lot more. Meyer brought the scalpel into the crack. He saw the now gigantic blade slide into the cleft of the valley, testing the ragged walls. He paused just a bit and, "Do you see anything, Bob?" Turner asked. "Are the sensors still intact?" Meyer sensed the other technician behind him, standing very still, but he was standing well back, still disowning his offspring. Meyer pushed against one wall with the blade, trying to nudge it open a bit more. The eye seemed intact. He moved the blade to the other side, pushing gently, then with a bit more force. Except for the crack, the eye seemed fine, nothing wrong with it at all. "No," Meyer said. "Everything's..." He was still looking at the giant eye, the giant blade. He nodded to Turner. They'd be able to get the circuits up and running. Maybe see what had happened. The blade moved. Something gave way. The eye moved. It seemed to slide out of the black, crusty hole, pop out into the air. Without thinking, Meyer recoiled. It had to be flying right at him. He tried looking for the eye, but everything was, of course, oversized. A great smeary crystalline blur. "Where is it?" he muttered. "What the hell happened to it?" He heard it fall. "Damn it," he said. I guess it was loose," Turner said, annoyingly repeating the obvious. "Right," Meyer agreed. He flipped up his visor. The twin hemisphere of the lone eye were at his feet, useless now, completely disconnected from the CPU of the good guy doll's computer chips. They'd have to put in new ones now, rebuild the entire thing, just to see if they could figure out what in the world. He looked up at Chucky's head. God, it looked even more like a skull now. Most of its tough plastic teeth were gone, and now it had two black sockets where its bright blue eyes used to be. And it was staring right at Meyer. Funny thing, he thought, taking a breath. He could still see the puffy pouches of the good guy doll's cheeks, as if it were still a happy little good guy. Sure, smiling right at him, just waiting for its next adventure. "Okay," he said to Turner. "Let's start rebuilding the sucker." It hadn't been easy getting the doll from the DA's office. No, Sullivan thought as he looked out the window of his limo. His Lincoln rumbled across the Wacker Street Bridge. A hint of color touched the sky. A bit of purple, a pale orange. He reached out and took another sip of his latte. Tom Sullivan wasn't used to such early hours. Not anymore. Not since the small company that he had begun with, just one toy concept, had turned into an entire industry. It wasn't just the good guy doll and accessories anymore. There was the weekly good guy TV show, ever steady in the afternoon ratings, no matter in which time slot that some local station stuck it. And there was the movie, finally with a halfway decent script, a live-action good guy film with some major money behind it. The income from the good guy clothes alone was more than what Sullivan had made in his first 5 years. This good guy was the horn of plenty. There seemed to be no end, no limit. Until the incident. That's how he referred to it. The incident. The police had their own theory, one that the press had jumped on with their usual bloodlust for a hot story. The tabloids went crazy. The strange little boy and his killer doll. Maybe someone in the Playpals factory had tampered with one of the dolls, you know, altered its circuits so that it said, "Hi, I'm Chucky, the Lakeside Strangler." And maybe it was programmed to do other more malevolent tricks. But the police wouldn't let Sullivan have the doll. What was left of it, anyway, a chunk of the torso all burned out, and the head. Not until, that is, last night. Finally, his lawyers were able to obtain a court order, forcing the DA to hand the remains over, now that the principals were all accounted for, the mother, the kid. The DA's office was curious about the doll, too. The facts of the matter were simple enough. Nobody knew what had happened, not a clue. In the meantime, the sales of good guy dolls, good guy toys, and good guy clothes quickly declined. Some stations even dropped the good guy's show. It was bad, and it looked as if it could get worse. Unless, Sullivan thought, we'd find out what did happen to that damn doll. He took another sip of coffee. It was cold, almost oily on his lips. He spat it back into the cup. His limo hit a bump, and some of the latte sloshed over onto the black carpet, nearly dotting his shoes. He didn't want to get involved. At first, he thought he would just let his technicians work on the doll, let them play detective. But then his lawyer pointed out one key fact. "It's your company, Tom, and no matter what went wrong, it's your neck on the chopping block." He rubbed his cheek, feeling the rubbery texture of his skin. "I need my morning workout," he thought. "My bowl of oat bran, a massage, a steam bath." Instead, the limo took a deserted corner, turning away from the pale blue glow that was blooming in the east. Sullivan looked out the window, right at the Playpals building, right at the oversized good guy who waved at a sleeping Chicago from atop the building. The good guy's giant arm went up and down, and his eyes blinked. His freckled cheeks looked even rosier, highlighted by the first light of dawn. Sullivan looked up at the giant doll as they passed by the building and thought, "It looks like a monster, a giant creature out of a Japanese horror film. Attack of the killer good guy." The limo stopped. His door was popped open, and his smile faded. Meanwhile, the scalpel hit metal. Probably a screw, Meyer thought. The head armature itself was made of a fire-resistant plastic. Meyer scraped away the burnt covering, then leaned over to his silver tool tray and wiped his blade clean, leaving a thick tar-like paste behind. This was more like sculpting than cleaning, because the goo was solid, and he had to chisel through it. Finally, he leaned back and looked at the head. "Well, what do you think?" he said to Turner. The older technician stood a bit closer, less frightened now that the burnt black covering was breaking off.
You've got most of it."
"Okay, well then, how about some chompers for the boy?" Meyer stuck his plastic-covered fingers into the doll's open mouth. He sensed Turner tightening up, thinking, Meyer guessed, "Better you than me, pal." Meyer watched his fingers disappear into Chucky's black maw as he dug around for the molars. He felt them, all wobbly and loose, and quickly popped them out. The doll only had two of its front teeth, and they both sprung free after a bit of tugging. He took a new set of teeth from the tray, two plastic semicircles of uppers and lowers. Meyer had to force them into the sockets. Something had obviously gotten a bit twisted in there. "Hand me the epoxy," he said to Turner. He saw Turner's hand shake as he handed him the small blue gun. Meyer filled the holes and gaps. He felt with a thin line of the fastener.
"We should hurry," Turner said.
Meyer looked up at the clock. 5:40 a.m. Disgustingly early in the morning. They had only 20 minutes left. 20 minutes before the boss arrived.
Okay, Meyer said. "I'm almost done here."
Meyer picked up the latex mold that fit flush to the doll's head. He held it in place and then grabbed a staple gun. He pressed the trigger. shooting the staples into the edge of the mold. The doll had skin again. He picked up a clear piece of acetate covered with orange dots. He pressed it against the doll's new face, and presto, it had freckles. "Hey, kid," Meyer said to the doll, "you're not looking so bad." But the doll still had a smudgy black cranium. Turner handed Meyer the hair. "Nice mop. God, where did they get that color? Red?" Meyer positioned the hair on the doll's head. It didn't seem to land right. First a bit too far forward, then a bit back, always exposing some of the burned shell. Finally, Meyer just shrugged and brought the staple gun up again to fasten the scalp down. It didn't have to look perfect. "Okay, Hal, he's all yours now." Meyer backed away as Turner carried a good guy torso over to the head. The overalls were a brilliant blue, and the colorful striped shirt shone in the light. Turner seemed to take forever fitting the head to the body. Then he stepped back, admiring his work. He looked around and picked up the arms. He started putting one in the wrong socket, getting the hand backward. "Oh," he said to himself. "What's the guy so shook up about?" Meyer wondered. "Is he worried because he helped create the good guy? Is he afraid he'll lose his pension?" Turner finally got the arms right. Then he put the legs on. One of the doll's red sneakers slid off. "I'll get it," Meyer said. He bent down to the floor and picked it up. The sneaker's sole had pictures imprinted on it of objects important in the good guy universe. A teepee, a horse, an airplane, a hammer. A hammer. Oh, the babysitter, the woman's friend, had been killed by a good guy hammer, right through the skull, and then she fell out the window 7 stories down. The kid said that Chucky must have done it. Nobody believed that, but that just left the kid as the numero uno suspect. Meyer stood up and put the sneaker on, and then he looked up. The doll was staring blankly right at him, almost complete, almost intact, almost new. "Now for some baby blues." He reached out and took the 2 eyes off the tray. He felt the back of each eye for the small 9-pin connectors that plugged right into the head's computer board, which, unless he was crazy, had to be malfunctioning. But their orders were to try and get the doll up and running, if it was possible. He fit the eyes into an attachment on the laboratory drill that hung suspended over the doll. The drill would lower the eyes into the skull and plug them in. He popped each eye into the attachment. Then, hesitating for one grisly moment, he stuck a finger into each eye socket, making sure the black holes were clear. He had his fingers stuck in the holes. Then he heard a sound. After a moment, he realized it was the sound of the elevator arriving, just down the hall. Meyer looked back at the doll, complete except for the eyes, and said, "Hello, Chucky. It's showtime, buddy." "Good morning, Mr. Sullivan." Sullivan nodded. He saw Mattson, his operations VP, standing beside the chauffeur, looking cold and uncomfortable. Good, Sullivan thought. At least that makes me feel better. Then he saw the briefcase dangling from Mattson's hand. "I've got a board meeting in an hour. I hope you have some good news," Sullivan said. He walked past the chauffeur, heading straight into the building. Mattson hurried to walk alongside Sullivan. Yes, Mr. Sullivan. There's some good news, and..." Mattson ran ahead, turning to Sullivan in mid-stammer. He grabbed the door that led into the research and development building. Sullivan had to break his pace while Mattson fumbled opening it. "Yes, go on," Sullivan said. "Your news?" He walked inside and immediately smelled the plastic, a sweet, dizzying, all-pervasive odor. Sullivan didn't like coming here anymore. Mattson popped open his briefcase, propping it against his body as he walked. He took out some manila folders. "There are the sales records, Mr. Sullivan. They seem to have bottomed out. Whatever, damage we're going to take, we've taken." "And the police?" "They've denied the whole story. Everything the boy and the mother said.
They're willing to wait until we're done, until we've come up with some answer. Matson handed Sullivan the first folder, a sales graph. Then he handed him two more. The mother. She's been placed under court-ordered psychiatric observation, and I think the cops involved have been put on paid leave. Nobody wants the story to get out. At least not the way she told it. Sullivan nodded. They walked to the elevator at the end of the corridor. Sullivan beat an embarrassed Matson to the button. Then he flipped open the folder labeled Barclay Karen. He looked at her photo. She was a pretty woman, a sales clerk who sold jewelry. There was nothing in the photo to indicate that she was an unbalanced woman. Matson handed him another photo. Barclay, Andy. The boy is still at the Glencoe Children's Crisis Center. He's going to be placed with foster parents until his mother is out. He'll also get regular counseling, therapy. Matson paused and Sullivan shot him a glance. But he's been sticking to his story. Says the doll was real, sir, that it was alive, that it... The elevator arrived with a cheerful ding, and Sullivan hurried in. After all, he didn't want to hear any of that malarkey. Not a bit of it. Chapter 2. Matson pushed open the door for him while Sullivan glanced up at the sign that said, Research and Development. How long has it been since I've been here, he thought. Not since the early days. And as he walked into the observation room of the lab, he saw that a lot of things had changed. He faced an enormous plate glass window with a panoramic view of the lab, which was enormous. Black boxes lined one wall, and various drills and hoists were suspended from the ceiling. Everything needed to design and test the modern toy. But Sullivan's eyes focused on the two technicians standing in the bright pool of light, concentrating on the doll. "Can they hear us?" he said to Matson. "Yes, if you want," Matson pointed at a switch. "Good morning, gentlemen," Sullivan said, flicking the switch on. He saw the two technicians look up. Then he recognized Hal Turner. "We go back a long way together," Sullivan thought. "A long way. There would be no good guys without Turner." And he probably knew that. Turner squinted in the darkness. "Good morning, Mr. Sullivan," the other technician said, answering for them both. Sullivan saw Hal Turner wave weakly. The craziness had to be confusing him. It's partly his baby, after all. "Are you all set in there, Bob?" Matson said. "Just about," the younger technician said. "We're ready to put the new eyes in." "That's Bob Meyer," Matson said. "One of the best microchip boys. He'll find out what's wrong," Matson said confidently to Sullivan. He radiated the confidence that Sullivan didn't share at all. "Okay," Bob Meyer said. "That should be it. Hal, would you bring the drill down a bit?" Sullivan noticed that Meyer seemed to be calling the shots. Turner was just an old lab man. Sullivan watched Meyer take the doll and turn it horizontally. Now both its head and torso were held by clamps. Then Meyer reached up to the drill. Sullivan saw the attachment on the drill, two prongs holding marble-shaped objects, the eyes. "Okay," Meyer said, looking over at the observation room. "We should be able to see what's working and what's not working in this baby." Sullivan heard him mutter something that he apparently didn't think the microphones would pick up, which is probably nothing. The whir of the drill started, amplified loudly in the observation room. Sullivan winced at the screeching noise. Matson said, "Should I lower the volume, sir? I can." Sullivan shook his head. He wanted to hear everything, see everything. Meyer reached up for the prongs. "The doll's been rebuilt from the ground up, Mr. Sullivan. Everything except the integrated circuits and the microprocessor inside the head. The brains of the thing. But it could be that could be a wash, too. We'll know soon enough." Sullivan looked down. He noticed that he had clenched his fist, that he was gripping the edge of the table. He brought his hands up and flexed them, splaying his fingers out, trying to relieve the tension. "Easy," he told himself. "It's all over. This is just an investigation. No, it's more like an autopsy. Just to see whether we have any blame, any culpability in this matter." The drill sound changed. Sullivan saw Turner lean closer, looking over Meyer's shoulder as he lowered the machine
that would insert the eyes. And then, just when Sullivan was about to take a breath, the drill went silent. He heard Meyer say, "Hey, well, what's wrong?" Turner went back to the base of the machine, looking at it, flicking buttons. "I don't know, there isn't anything..." Mattson coughed, and then the whirring sound returned, but louder, crazed now, out of control. And the machine plunged down violently into the doll's head, jabbing down as though stabbing at the doll. Meyer's hand was still on it, trying to guide it. At first, tiny sparks flew off the machine, then more sparks and bigger sparks, until Sullivan saw Meyer gyrating uncontrollably, while holding on to the machine, as if he were a puppet being jerked around by some bored kid. The sparks flew into the air. They fell onto the floor, glowing for seconds at a time. Meyer, with great effort, turned around and faced the observation booth, his hands still locked on the machine, frozen by the electricity running through the machine right into him. "Jesus!" Mattson said. Meyer's eyes bulged right out, looking at Sullivan. Tiny plumes of smoke rose up from his body, and Sullivan had a creepy thought. "At least we can't smell anything in here." Hal Turner ran over to Meyer, but Mattson screamed, "Don't touch him!" Then Sullivan heard a crackling noise, even louder than the machine's whirr. The lights flashed, and Meyer came flying right off his feet, like a man shot out of a cannon for an insane circus trick. Mattson pulled Sullivan back, just as the technician crashed through the glass. He landed at Sullivan's feet, and then it was dark. "We've blown the power! How the hell could we have?" But Sullivan knelt down. He felt around the floor for Meyer's body. His fingers touched the shards of glass. A toothpick-sized piece punctured his skin, then another. Finally, he felt Meyer. He felt the steady rise and fall of the man's chest. "He's alive!" he shouted at Mattson. "Damn it, he's alive! Call somebody, do!" He heard Mattson feeling along the nearby table, then the chatter of a phone. "We need a medic down in R&D, and hurry!" Sullivan heard footsteps, then Turner spoke from outside the room. "Is he all right?" "Hell," Sullivan said. "Do you have a flashlight in there?" Sullivan heard the drawers of a nearby desk being opened, and then Turner's voice again. "Got it!" A click, and a pitifully narrow beam of light escaped from a very small flashlight. Turner trained it on Sullivan, then down to Meyer. "Is he okay? Did..." But he stopped. Sullivan stopped breathing. Everyone stopped breathing. There was sound, a small sound, movement, from somewhere back near the lab bench. Turner quickly swiveled the light from Meyer back to the smoky blackness of the lab. "What was that?" Turner said. He brought the light up. Sullivan saw the outline of the machine, the drill. The prongs were empty. There was no doll. "It must have blown the doll away," Mattson said hollowly. But even as he said it, they all heard more sounds, more little sounds, just like... Sullivan shook his head. "No, it's just my imagination. I'm just all shaken up and..." "Oh, God! Oh, damn!" It was Turner. He had dropped the flashlight. It clattered to the floor, and for a moment Sullivan thought it would go out. "Oh, something just stabbed my leg," Turner said. "God, I think I'm cut!" Then, from out of the smoky blackness, there was a buzzing noise again, and the light flashed on. Sullivan blinked at the sudden glare. The side door to the lab opened up, and two of the factory's medics came running in. And Sullivan saw what was sitting by the door. It was the doll. "What the hell?" Mattson said. "Go get it," Sullivan said. "Get it now," he ordered Mattson. Mattson nodded. He opened the door of the observation room. The broken glass crunched under his feet. One of the medics went to Turner while the others kneeled beside Meyer. Sullivan watched Mattson. He seemed to be walking so slowly over to the doll, which was still sitting on the floor, right by the door. He stopped just in front of it, and then cautiously bent over and picked it up. Sullivan took a breath and moved out of the observation room to Mattson, who was turning around holding the doll, turning slowly, holding it at arm's length. All of a sudden, it spoke. "Hi," it sang in that syrupy sweet voice.
The head swiveled left and right. The eyes blinked once and then again. "I'm Chucky, and I'm your friend to the end. Hidey-ho! Ha ha ha!" Matson kept holding it away from himself as if it smelled bad. Sullivan whispered to him,
"Not a word of this to anyone, you understand? Not a good goddamn word to anyone."
He took Matson's arm and squeezed it hard enough to hurt.
"You put a lid on this thing, you understand? You smother it. The newspapers will never hear about this, will they?"
Matson shook his head. Sullivan let go of his arm.
"I have to get ready for my meeting," Sullivan said.
He looked over at Turner, who had a blotched red bandage wrapped around his calf.
"Are you okay, Hal?"
Hal Turner looked up and nodded.
Yes, but..." "You must have leaned into some glass," Sullivan said. "Gave you a nasty cut."
Sullivan kept walking toward the door, out of the lab.
But Mr. Sullivan," Matson said, "what should I do with the doll? Will we still test it, or..."
Sullivan stopped, turned, and sneered at Matson. "That damn doll," he thought.
"I don't care what you do with it, Matson. Just make sure I never, ever see the damn thing again."
Matson nodded, and Sullivan left the lab, the electrical smell following him out of the corridor. He walked to the elevator, shaking his head, thinking, "Hidey-ho, indeed."
Okay, Slashaholics, this has been chapters 1 and 2 of Child's Play 2, the novelization of the movie by Matthew J. Costello. I gotta say, just right off the bat, I've always considered Child's Play 2 one of the best horror slasher sequels ever made. I think it's actually superior to Child's Play 1, though I did love Child's Play 1. And I'm also one of the weird people that love Child's Play 3. Hell, I love all the Child's Play movies and the Chucky movies. The only one that's not like my favorite is Seed of Chucky, but I enjoy it for a different reason. It's a hell of a horror comedy movie. You know, Bride of Chucky had a lot of camp to it, but not as much as Seed. Seed just went all in on the comedy stuff. But we're talking about Child's Play 2, and more specifically, we're talking about chapters 1 and 2 right now. What did you guys think, you know? I always loved the opening of this movie. I thought it was handled very well for bringing back Chucky, since he was destroyed so much in the first one. I thought it was handled great in the movie. Thought it was handled great in the novelization tonight, in these chapters. I thought the writer does a great job putting you in the moment. He's very descriptive, but at the same time, not too descriptive, and he leaves some of it to your imagination, and I really appreciate that in a writer. But yeah, the build-up was great. You know, when everything went to hell was written great. It felt great. I didn't want to stop reading, to be honest with you. I'm looking forward to getting back to this one as soon as possible, and I hope you guys enjoyed it too. I can only imagine what this author is going to do with the meat and potatoes of this story, you know, with the whole Andy and Kyle story, you know, because I'm really looking forward to how he handles that. Because obviously he went into more detail with a lot of the stuff that happened in the opening of the movie and the opening of the book, and I really hope he does that in more of the book. I hope he adds more of his own, you know, original ideas to the story. So I'm really excited about it. But I do want to say, guys, before we get to like the Chucky talking scenes, I cannot do a perfect, or anywhere close to a perfect, Chucky voice. I can tell you that right now. I'm going to do what I did with Freddy, and that's I'm going to try to take what's known as the voice for Freddy, what's known for the voice as Chucky. I'm going to try to hold on to at least like 10% of that and give it my own twist. You know, I'm going to give it my own take, but I'm going to try to keep just a little twinge of that voice there for you guys so it's not just horrible. You got a little taste of that with my laugh at the beginning of the story tonight. I hope that wasn't horrible. Hope you guys enjoyed that. And I hope when we get to the, you know, parts where Chucky's talking and stuff that you guys are okay with my take on it.
There was no way I was going to be able to do a perfect Brad Dourif impersonation. So I'm going to try to just hold on, like I said, to like a 10% of what he does and just do what I can with my own voice and make it my own. And I hope that's okay with you guys. All right, until next time, this has been your friendly neighborhood 80s slasher librarian saying, thanks for listening, and you can't keep a good guy down.
Hi, this is Jeffrey Reddick, creator of Final Destination.
Greetings, Slashaholics. This is David Bergantino, author of the Freddy Krueger's Tales of Terror books, the Bard's Blood Horror Shakespeare books.
Hey guys, this is Jason Brooks, Jason Voorhees from Friday the 13th Vengeance.
Hey, this is Slasher Pepper.
Hey everybody, it's CJ Graham, Jason, Friday the 13th, part 6.
This is William Patterson, known to Friday the 13th fans as Eric Morris.
Hi, this is Deborah Voorhees from Friday the 13th, part 5.
Hey folks, this is Adam Marcus, director of Jason Goes to Hell and Secret Santa.
Hello kiddies, this is John Kassir, the voice of the Crypt Keeper.
Hi, this is Kane Hodder, better known as Jason from Friday the 13th, Victor Crowley from Hatchet.
And you're listening.
You're listening.
And you're listening.
And you're listening.
That's why I make sure you guys know you're listening.
You are listening.
And you are listening.
And you are lucky enough to be listening.
Okay, boils and ghouls, you are listening.
You are listening
to the 80s Slasher Librarian.
To the 80s Slasher Librarian.
To the 80s Slasher Librarian.
The 80s Slasher Librarian.
To the 80s Slasher Librarian.
To 80s Slasher Librarian.
To 80s Slasher Librarian.
To the 80s Slasher Librarian.
To the 80s Slasher Librarian.
To the 80s Slasher Librarian. Keep listening, or I'll kill you.